How specific do you need to be in your AI patent, and how broadly can you claim the invention if it involves AI? That's what I'm going to be talking about in this video. So for a little bit of context, the other day I was posting on LinkedIn about a decision of one of the boards of appeal of the European Patent Office on this topic, and I was asking whether it makes sense to talk about this in more detail in a separate video. Many of you said yes, so here's the video. But in case you came here from other sources, hi, my name is Bastian Best. I'm a European patent attorney with a passion for patents for the digital future, in particular for patents and artificial intelligence. And the question what to reveal in the patent application is really a practical one. So the other day I was working on a PCT patent application, which I had drafted myself, and in the international search report, the patent examiner said the following, and I'm citing, "The skilled person is aware that the term convolutional neural network denotes a neural network architecture which cannot be used for the claimed purpose unless suitably trained. Therefore, the concrete steps of training the network are essential for defining the invention. As said steps are not part of current claim 1, said claim is not inventive because it cannot solve the technical problem posed." So this video has three parts. First of all, I will outline the fundamentals of patents for AI so that we're all on the same page. Secondly, I will walk you through the Board of Appeal decision. And number three, I will give you my two cents and some practical recommendations for drafting patent applications for maximum success at the European Patent Office. So stick around, it will be worth it, and please don't forget to hit the like button, that would be very kind, okay? So when I talk about patents and AI, I basically get variations of three questions all the time. The number one question is, can inventions in AI be patented? For example, a new machine learning technique, a new training algorithm, things like that. The short answer is, European patents are granted for technical inventions, meaning for non-obvious solutions to technical problems. At the European Patent Office, the more mathematical foundations of AI, like the computational models and the algorithms, are in themselves not considered technical, so those cannot be patented in themselves. What can be patented are either technical applications of those mathematical foundations or technical implementations. So this is kind of an advanced topic which would certainly justify an own video, so in case this is interesting to you, let me know in the comments if you want to see a separate video on that. The second question is, what about inventions by AI? So what happens if an AI itself comes up with a new invention? That's not easy to answer. So for example, if a human engineer uses AI as a tool to, let's say, design the optimal shape of an airplane wing, that optimal shape can be patented if it is novel and inventive, of course. The European Patent Office and most of the patent offices around the world say no, the inventor in patent law has to be a human being, but there are currently two appeal cases pending before the European Patent Office that address specifically that question. Also, this topic would be enough material for an own video, so again, let me know in the comments if that's interesting. And question number three, what level of detail do you have to provide in the patent application in order to meet the enablement requirement, which is called sufficiency of disclosure in the European Patent Convention? As I said, the remainder of this video will be about that question, which immediately brings me to chapter 2, the Board of Appeal decision. So the title of this decision is Äquivalenter Aortendruck, which is German and means equivalent aortic pressure. So the case is about medical informatics in the broadest sense, and the decision is written in German language because the application was filed in German. You might know that the European Patent Office has three official languages, English, French, and German, and applicants can file applications in either of these three languages, and the European Patent Office will then also respond in that language. So here we are talking about an examination appeal, which means that the patent application was refused in the first instance by the examining division, here for a lack of inventive step. The applicant filed an appeal against the refusal. The Board of Appeal then issued a preliminary opinion, which was negative, in which they basically sided with the first instance concerning lack of inventive step, but they also raised another objection, and that was Article 83, which means insufficiency of disclosure or lack of enablement. Interestingly, the applicant did not use the opportunity for oral proceedings, so the Board of Appeal in the end decided in writing without a hearing. So what about the invention? The invention was about a method of determining cardiac output. Cardiac output means the amount, the volume of blood which is pumped by the heart per time unit. And I've learned that a healthy person, the heart of a healthy person, normally does like 4.5 or 5 liters per minute. Under a heavy load, it might even go up as high as 30 liters per minute. That's one of the interesting things about being a patent attorney. You always learn interesting new fun facts. Now, in order to determine this parameter, the cardiac output, you need to measure the aortic pressure. The aorta, that's the main blood vessel in the body. So in the prior art, there have been invasive methods which really go into the body and therefore are suitable only for intensive care scenarios. But in the prior art, there were also non-invasive methods, one of them being to measure the blood pressure at the periphery, which means to measure basically the pulse at the wrist. And then the prior art used a mathematical model to transform the pulse value into the equivalent aortic pressure. Now, the patent application we are looking at here criticized that this prior art approach was quite inaccurate and involved a very complicated mathematical model which used a lot of processing resources. So the technical problem was how to determine the cardiac output more precisely with a minimum of required processing power. The solution to that problem is defined in the patent claims. Again, this patent application was drafted in German, so let's read claim 1 of the US counterpart, which is almost identical. So it's about a method for determining cardiac output from an arterial blood pressure curve measured at a peripheral region. The method has a number of steps which just describe the prior art approach, which I mentioned before. So you measure the blood pressure at the periphery, at the pulse, for example. Then you arithmetically transform this curve to an equivalent aortic pressure, and then you calculate the cardiac output from this equivalent aortic pressure. Now, the characterizing feature in this invention was that this arithmetic transformation from the pulse to the aortic pressure basically was performed by the aid of an artificial neural network having weighting values that are determined by learning. So as you can see, the basic idea behind this patent application was to take the known approach of indirectly deriving the aortic pressure, but to replace the complicated and inaccurate mathematical model of the prior art with a neural network. And as I said, the Board of Appeal had doubts whether the patent application provided an enabling disclosure for this invention. So let's look at the legal basics briefly. That's Article 83 in the European Patent Convention, which says that the European patent application shall disclose the invention in a manner sufficiently clear and complete for it to be carried out by a person skilled in the art. As I said, that's kind of similar to the enablement requirement in the US patent system. And in the decision, the Board of Appeal noted that in order to meet this requirement, the disclosure of the invention in the application must enable the person skilled in the art to reproduce the claimed invention using his or her common general knowledge. On the one hand, this means that the patent application does not have to include each and every tiny detail so that any person on the street can reproduce the invention, but the patent application addresses the person skilled in the art, and the person skilled in the art reads the technical teaching disclosed in this application with his common general knowledge. Now, the problem with this particular case was that the patent application revealed only rather generic statements about the neural network and how it was trained. For example, and I'm citing again from the US counterpart, one of the statements was that to train the neural network, it is moreover crucial that measuring data from patients of different ages, sexes, constitutional types, health conditions and the like be used. So, somewhat specific, but it doesn't reveal how to train the neural network. And this led the Board of Appeal to say then the following. I'm translating on the fly. The application does not disclose which input data are suitable for training the claimed artificial neural network, or at least one data set suitable for solving the technical problem. So that's an interesting statement. The Board of Appeal would have required at least one concrete data set or at least a definition of the training data that was used to train the neural network so that the neural network can perform its task, namely determining the cardiac output as in the claim. So the Board of Appeal could have basically stopped here, but they nevertheless took the opportunity to also comment on inventive step. Again, the problem of this invention, the technical problem to be solved, was how to more accurately determine the cardiac output with less computing resources. The solution was to use an artificial neural network, the weighting values of which are determined by learning, period. Now, the appellant, of course, argued that this level of abstraction already provides technical advantages. For example, he said that the neural network makes the whole determination more robust and more precise, while taking into account the narrow band nature of the transmission path in the blood vessels and the resonance phenomena in the low frequency range. Sounds very technical indeed, but the Board of Appeal did not follow those arguments, basically for three reasons. First of all, they said that the neural network as it is defined in the claim on that level of abstraction did not take account of those technical characteristics. Secondly, they said that the mere statement in the claim that the training values are determined by learning is not more than a placeholder statement for any neural network, because any artificial neural network has to be trained. And the third point was that the artificial neural network, on the level of abstraction as it was defined in the claim, was not specifically adapted to the claimed application, namely to the determination of the aortic pressure. So in the end, the Board of Appeal found both a lack of enablement and a lack of inventive step, and therefore they dismissed the appeal so that the patent application remains refused. So what can we learn from this decision? Well, I guess the overall point is quite obvious. If you want to get a patent on an AI invention, you can't just describe it as a black box. That's basically the basic patent deal. If you want a legal monopoly on the invention, you have to inform the public about how the invention works so that the public can understand it, can build upon it, and can advance the state of the art. So from a pure patentability perspective, my advice is, of course, put in as many details as possible into the application about the technical realization of the artificial intelligence aspects of the invention. But in practice, this is of course sometimes neither practical nor desirable, because I know many clients who put tremendous efforts into collecting, structuring, labeling the training data, so they would never reveal that training data because it's their secret sauce. And I think that's also one point where this decision kind of falls short, because in my opinion, it focuses too much on the training data. Of course, there are many AI inventions, the quality of which depends on the training data used for adjusting the neural network to the specific task. But there are also other examples. For example, in other cases, it might be the specific structure of the neural network that makes up the invention. So the number of layers, the number and type of neurons and their connections. So you would have to reveal rather that structure to provide for an enabling disclosure, in my opinion. In yet other cases, it could be the training method. So what kinds of algorithms do you use to train the invention? That could, in certain applications, be more decisive for the quality of the outcome than the concrete training data itself. So in my opinion, it all depends on the particular AI invention at hand. In some cases, it might be that you indeed would have to reveal the training data. In many other examples, there would be other ways to provide for an enabling disclosure. So maybe one way to provide for an enabling disclosure would be not to provide the training data, the input, but to define the output, namely the trained weights. So the idea would be to provide one specific example of a fully trained network, for example, in the form of a specific table with, let's say, thousands of concrete weights. And my guess would be that in many cases, it would be even possible to kind of reveal the second best solution and to keep the really optimum solution still secret. One last point on inventive step. Sufficiency of disclosure relates to the patent application as a whole. The application, including the description and the figures, must enable the skilled person to reproduce the invention. For inventive step, that's different, because for inventive step, in the claim, it must be plausible that the technical effect is actually achieved, meaning that the claim itself has to be so specific as to allow a plausibility argument that the technical effect is achieved. So what you want to do in practice is you start with a very broad claim, of course, for maximum protection. And then what you need is a hierarchy of technically meaningful fallback positions in the dependent claims and the description. And also you should explain in the description for each fallback position why it is technically meaningful. So in this way, you can then amend your claims to circumvent the objections of the examiner in a step-by-step controlled manner. That's a whole topic for a separate video, again, if you would be interested. Okay, so that's it for this video. Now, please do me a favor. If you enjoyed this particular topic, hit the like button. And maybe you know someone who should watch this video, so maybe you could share it with him or her. If you would like to see more of those kind of longer videos, subscribe to my channel. This way I can see how many people are interested. And of course, feedback, comments, and even topic suggestions are highly appreciated in the comments below. Okay, now don't forget to hit the like button and see you next time.